So, hello everybody. Thank you all for being here. This is a talk on Semaphore. It introduces the Semaphore Cloud Platform. Okay, I'm Vangelis Koukis. I work for the Greek Research and Education Network. It's called GERNET. And Semaphore is Greek for cloud. Okay, now that we got that behind the back, the question that must resonate in everybody's mind right now is, why the hell do we need another cloud platform, right? I mean, we've already solved most of our problems, or there are many open source cloud approaches, so why would we need another one? This talk tries to focus on what we do differently, on how we follow a more layered approach, how we try to reuse existing technologies, how we build everything together to solve our problem, and the process discovering that perhaps this solves other people's problems as well, so why not use it as open source? Our motivation was the Okeanos project. Okeanos is Greek for ocean, because we want to create an ocean of resources. We want to build production, quality, infrastructure, and service, mainly focusing the Greek academic and research community. We want to have a very simple, super easy, super simple, web-based user interface for students, for researchers to be able to get their own VMs. From the very start, we decided that we would either use components or build our own or combine them, it would be released as open source. Now, how does one do that? We needed persistent VMs. This is also an interesting issue. Mark, in a previous conversation, mentioned the whole Amazon Light Cloud and are your VMs, your pets, or your cattle, and you let them die and then you'll spawn some new ones. If you're targeting people who need their VMs to put their data inside and use them all the time, then they are their pets, then they better stay out. How do you do that? We want to do it. We want to explore how to do it. I think we managed to do it using commodity hardware, so there is no expensive storage area network, specialized fiber channel things. We want to scale to the thousands. How do we do it? What kind of software, open source software, do you use right now to build this kind of infrastructure? Any ideas? Okay, so I'm sure we know the word that comes to mind. Okay. In the following, I'll be using OpenStack as an example. It's not OpenStack itself, it's more or less most open source cloud approaches. This project has been running since December 2010 or November 2010. So we've been, we did an initial evaluation back then, but what I'm going to talk about most of all is for today as well. So the thing is, most open source cloud approaches, they either take it all or leave it. They touch everything from the hypervisor to the user interface. We know how to do everything, so we'll touch every single layer. And building a cloud, and especially if their code is fast-paced and ever-evolving things, how do you build something on technology that is constantly evolving? Perhaps we should try and decouple the problems into layers and determine whether we can use existing things for a few of the layers so that we can minimize the amount of work that we have to do. So we went back and tried to decompose the problem of building a cloud service into distinct layers. And this is what we came up with. There's the hypervisor layer we chose to build in KVM. Then there's the node layer, where the software knows that there are many KVM processes and it runs a single node, a single physical node, and can start and stop processes, and it can manage the local storage on the node itself, and it can create network bridges, it can do things like that. Then there's the cluster layer. The cluster layer knows that there are many physical nodes, and it manages them as a group. And the cluster is a self-contained management unit. So the cluster knows how to do resource allocation, it's self-consistent, and it has its own request queue, perhaps. And it's self-sufficient. Then there's the cloud layer, which is essentially the implementation of the API. And it's a completely different thing from the classic layer, in a way that I'm going to describe afterwards. Then there's the API specification, which is not a software layer per se, but we basically have different books that we show that the API specification is not tied to the API implementation. Then there's the user interface layer, which is outside the actual server side system. Now, there's a big difference between the three lower levels and the three upper levels. There are two different mindsets that we need on this volume, this thick line. The three lower levels, it's things that we already know how to do. This is a compute cloud, the same holds for a storage cloud. The three lower layers is traditional VM management. Because at its heart, you know, when I first started learning about the cloud, what is the cloud? Okay, it's essentially managing VMs. We already know how to manage VMs. And it's a difficult thing to do. So the three lower layers are all about processes and signals and synchronization and resource allocation and blocking and request queuing and storage management and configuration of switches and bridging and all these things. System level things that need to be done in a very precise way, that need to be rock solid, that need to be more systems oriented. The three upper layers, it's a completely different world. It's the world of APIs and JSON responses and XML and REST and SOAP and HTTP and jQuery on the client side and JavaScript and all these nice things. Are they the same thing? No, they're completely distinct. Different mindsets, different skill sets. Most cloud approaches, they try to do everything at once in single code base. So you get to having the same fast pace, ever evolving code, covering all layers. So it's two options. We chose KVM as the hypervisor. Okay, we had to fill in the boxes, okay? We either review something or build something of our own. We chose the OpenStack API because its momentum was tremendous. Everybody was behind it. We wanted to be compatible with third-party applications. We would build on the OpenStack Compute API. We would build on KVM. But then how do you fill the remaining boxes? OpenStack says, I have my own load layer. It's OpenStack plus LinkVirt to control the KVM process. I have my own cluster layer, a database that knows both about the VM process themselves, their states, and the API states, for example. I implement the API on my own, I'll do a UI on mine. Well, how do we fill the two lower boxes? Are there any nice tools that perhaps can do great VM cluster management? That's a difficult problem to have somebody else to solve. I mean, I can see him right now. Now, and perhaps we can reuse his code, his experience, and let a huge burden get off our backs, and perhaps we can focus on doing the other things. Are you aware of any nice cluster management tools that one could choose? Well, there was a great presentation online yesterday, and it's called Ganeri, and that's what we decided to use. If we use Ganeri, interrupt. If you haven't used Ganeri yet, please try it out and to remember my words. So we decided to build on Ganeri because Ganeri already knows how to do good cluster management and we didn't have to deal with it. And it's self-sufficient, self-contained. And it gave us, from the very first moment, reliable, migratable VMs. We could take VMs and migrate them from node to node because it knew how to handle, for example, local storage. I'll talk more about this later on. And what about the two other layers? They're much simpler right now. And they became synergy. They became our thin cloud layer above Ganeri that implements the OpenStack APIs and allows us to build compute and storage clusters. And this way we can keep this important important distinction between the cluster management and the cloud layer, and we can take advantage of Ganeli upgrades, and we can continuously upgrade the app layer to faster paced development without impacting the stability of the VMs themselves. So let's talk a bit about Ganeli so that we know more about how it fits our plan. Ganeli is mature, production ready VM cluster management software. It's used for Google's corporate infrastructure. It manages multiple storage backends out of the box. We embraced it, we contributed code to it. Submission supported LVM, local storage, DRPP. It can do mirroring among between distinct nodes so that VMs can migrate from node to node without having any actual shared storage at the physical level. It can do files on a local, on a shared directory. We added support for RDD, block storage devices, as I said. We also have the external storage interface, so the administrators are free to write scripts of their own to control external SAN or NAS devices. Ganeli is a number of nodes. Every node runs the node daemon. One of the nodes becomes the master and runs the master daemon. The master daemon knows about the cluster state, it keeps track of the request queue. It replicates the state of the cluster synchronously to a number of master candidates. So we can do master failovers on a single cluster. And it's way easy to integrate with existing infrastructure. So how does it get integrated into our infrastructure? We use the remote API that it offers over HTTP to control it, to act, connect, to do things. And we also have our custom pre- and post-execution hooks that notify us about anything that happens. In this plan, our compute and network part, we call it Kiklades, becomes a simple, nice, thin layer in Python and Django that works over multiple Ganeli clusters so that we can scale out to a very large number of nodes. And every cluster is self-contained. We implement the OpenStack API. We don't impose any restrictions on the networking part, that's all deployment side of things. We support public IPv4, IPv6 networks with total isolation between nodes of different users. That was one of our initial constraints. Every single VM had to be isolated. This is all done on the Ganeli side. And we can also do private networking at the logical layer. So every user can get distinct layer 2 segments, layer 2 private networks. And we either use a separate VLAN for each, or we can multiplex them over a single VLAN. This is the big picture. The user speaks the OpenStack API. There's a client-side web user interface. It's written in JavaScript with jQuery. Whatever the user can do over the API, he can also do over the UI and vice versa. The UI just speaks the OpenStack Compute API. Kiklades manages a number of Ganeli clusters. And there's the administrator, and the administrator can talk to Ganeli directly. And the administrator can do whatever is necessary to keep the VMs up and running. The Ganeli clusters are still Ganeli clusters. Now the right-hand side part is Pythos. Pythos is our storage part. And again, following the same cloud versus cluster distinction, we have implemented our storage service as a Python layer over a cluster management layer, which is either NFS or Rados or whatever else we have a driver for. But we are agnostic to the actual storage backend. So for Pythos, which also implements an OpenStack API, the OpenStack Object Storage API, every file is a collection of blocks. And these blocks are hashed, and they are referenced based on the unique ID that they get based on their contents. This gives us a very efficient syncing. A client says, I want to upload this file. This file is composed of blocks A, B, and A, B, and C. The server says, OK, I've got A, I've got B. Can you please give me C that I can create the file for you? The client says, send block C. The file is created. We get detoxification, we get partial bowel cancers because of that. PFAS is an integral part of Cinefor. It's our single store for files and VM images. Images are just files on PFAS. And PFAS uses a common backend with Archipelago, which is our volume service. Archipelago is responsible for creating volumes, disks for the VMs to boot with. So we can actually create live disks of images which are files on PFAS. This is PFAS. It's completely, its implementation is independent of the underlying cluster management layer. We have a driver for files over NFS or some other shared file system. And we've got a driver that works over safe Rados, the Rados object store. With all these things implemented, here are some of the cool things that we can do. This is an image of Ubuntu. And I can spawn the image into a VM. Now the VM is live, it has its own life cycle. Then I can freeze it into a new image. Okay, but what does that essentially mean for the underlying implementation? It means there's a snapshot of a disk, there's a frozen file system, there's a ghost tape somewhere, and I clone it into a live volume. Then the volume has its own life, and it changes, and new blocks are added and modified. Then I snapshot the volume back to a new file, a new snapshot, a new frozen thing. The left-hand side is files on PFAS. The right-hand side is volumes on Archipelago. Why should I do that? Because I can upload my golden Debian image as if it's a file. I can use seeking for that. Then I can spawn tens or hundreds of VMs out of it thinly, efficiently. And how does this happen? These are volumes, and volumes are just linearly addressable block spaces. And I've got my storage backend, which is a storage cluster management system, which is Rados in our case. How do I map from the linear block space to objects on Rados? On this Rados cluster, this is where the PFAS blocks are stored. This is where the user actually uploaded the image, so the blocks are already there. So what do I do? I use the Archipelago layer to map from large volumes to objects on Rados. So initially, all the blocks are mapped to the same objects. And as the user starts overwriting blocks, I do copy and write and create new objects for the blocks that have changed in volumes. And this is all running right now in our demo cluster and will be in production live this month. So Archipelago is unified storage for files, images, and volumes over a storage cluster, NFS or Rados. It's a thin layer. It allows for efficient seeking and sharing of images. Mm-hmm. Why? Because they're just thousand PFAS. And since we already have sharing for thousand PFAS, then we have sharing for images as well. So I can say I want this image or just upload it to be shared with this or that unit, that the user can use it to spawn VMs on GitHub. So this is how the big picture gets complete when Archipelago is added between the Gamet clusters and the Rados cluster that does serving of the objects. We've written drivers inside Gamet using the external storage interface to make calls to Archipelago for that. Now, how has this approach helped us move forward? We have rock solid VMs from day one. We were able to upgrade Ganeti and Cinefo independently. We were able to do Cinefo upgrades, once a month, and nothing broke. We were able to do database migrations without having to worry about the actual VM state, because the actual VM state wasn't in our database, so it was easier. We were able to do node evacuations, actually not we, the people who do operations. they just, you know, they had to keep the DNs up, so they were free to use whatever tools Ganeti provided. And there are external tools that work with Ganeti directly as well, like Ganeti Web Manager, for example. They can use graphical interfaces to do game migrations. We did a cross data center move from our old infrastructure, a few racks that had Intel processors, to AMD processors, and it worked. We abused the concept of the Ganeti cluster at this point because the cluster actually spanned data centers. We did a query numbering of all VMs with speeds that messed with database. It worked. We've got more than 2,600 VMs right now. We've got more than 800 users. We've got 7 Ganeti clusters currently in production. We want to scale when we reach beta. This is going to happen this month, more than 10,000 VMs. This is our goal. It seems feasible so far. I forgot to mention that we've been in Alpha since July 2011. We've got VMs running since July 2011. So this is more or less it. All of the Cinefa software is open source. You're free to download it, try it out, give us feedback. You're free to use our demo infrastructure at thecamnos.io. Please do so and tell us what you think about it. Thank you for your time. We're not using RDB for the backend. We're using Archipelago over objects on routers, which is essentially RDB, because RDB is a thin mapping from volumes to routers objects. But the thing is, we do mapping taking into account that Pythos has created the blocks so that we can map the content address of the blocks. That's it. But no, for Archipelago, we don't use local storage. But the user interface allows the user to actually select the kind of storage that he or she wants, because there was no way we were able to convince our administrators to just go to Rados-based things directly. Because, you know, Rados is not the most stable thing ever. So if you want to run enterprise-grade VMs, you have to use gRPC for a start. And then if you want thing provisioning and I want to run power notifications, I don't care if my nodes die, then okay, I'll get more Archipelago. There are actually buttons that one clicks and says, you know, I want gRPC based storage or I want Archipelago based storage.
Could you manage with configuration? Are you using
cookie
switch or
do
you
have to
use it?
We've evaluated it. We think it's a bit too immature to use right now, but we've carefully kept it in a different layer. It's on the Ganeti side. So Ganeti gives you this. It allows you to specify the script that brings up the interface for the hypervisor. And we've got a nice package, we call it Cinefa Networking, and you install it on the Ganeti node, and it takes care of things. What we're doing right now, we've got 3 modes. One mode is every private network, logical network, gets a separate VNAP. So it's easy. And you can run your own MAC addresses, and you can do whatever you want. You can do Microsoft load balancing, for example. That's user selectable as well on the API. We also have another node, that's what we're running in production right now, which runs all logical networks on a single VLAN with MAC prefix filtering. So we pick the MAC addresses and we make sure that MAC addresses with different prefixes, which belong to different logical networks, cannot see each other on the same VLAN. We use host-based filtering for that, imitators. And we have another node based on VXLAN, we have a prototype VXLAN implementation that does encapsulation of Ethernet frames over IP multicast. And it seems to be working pretty well. But all this is independent from the actual Cinefa code. It happens with different scripts on the Ganeti side.
What are the target users of this platform? What type of applications do you expect?
It's an IaaS service, so in theory, you can't know what kind of applications people run. But from an initial survey of what people wanted to use, there's mainly 3 kind of users. One is students who want to run their stack and do projects and run their MySQL and their web server and do something about new programming and have a server for their poster and things like that. One is researchers who want to do a large-scale scientific computation. So they want elastic VMs, elastic in the sense that I can't give you persistent, robust storage, but let's call it elastic, you know. this many fixed things, this kind of thing. Then there are these a bit more far-fetched. There are IT departments who want to run their servers on a camera. Then their servers are their pets. It was a nice analogy that Mark made. They must be kept up and running. These are the big three classes of users as you have identified.
There is a component in OpenStack which is called Cinder. Cinder, mm-hmm. dealing with storage. Mm-hmm. Would you consider taking just this part of OpenStack and integrate it, assuming it has functionalities that are appealing to you?
Of course, your approach seems
to be gathering pieces.
Of course, it's a matter of where we draw the line. OpenStack seems to be drawing vertical lines. So Cinder goes from the API to the drivers for storage. We like to draw horizontal lines. So we want to get storage management into Ganeti itself, because Ganeti logs, for example. Ganeti will log the appropriate sources for synchronization, for consistency, when it comes to allocation. So we mix one Ganeti context to allocate log storage. The API is, we will follow the API, of course, because it wants to be third party survival. But the actual implementation, I think we've already done something and it works and it fits our goals nicely, so I don't think we'll be considering the implementation soon. Thank you.